Welcome back to the Beavans family farm here in South Wales.
Now, last night we had 8 lambs born while we were live on air. There have been 32 born since then. It really is lambing live, isn't it, little ones? Well, it's our final show tonight, so we are going to be catching up with some old friends and looking ahead to the future. Sheep farming is a business, and it's one that the Beavan family depends on. So is it going to be a good year for them? Well, since we have been broadcasting from this farm, 100 ewes have given birth to a staggering 187 lambs, and there's still a couple hundred more to go. So hopefully it will be a good year for the Beavans. Also on the programme, I'm going to be finding out the difference between a loin chop and a rack. Adam's going to be getting up to something cheesy. But before all that, I know that you are desperate to discover what's in the box. Yes, last night it was Jim Beavan's birthday, and we gave him a large present, which was a little bit difficult to open, Jim, wasn't it? Yes, our packing left a lot to be desired, and I gather that there are a few people in the local pub watching the programme and yelling at the telly.
They would have shown it.
So are we going to tell them what was in it?
Nah, not yet.
No, we're going to tease you. We're going to tease you. And instead, what we're going to tell you about is one of the story of one of the triplets that was born last night. Have a look at this. This was while we were live on air. We had some triplets born. Oh, no, sorry, I'm completely wrong. There was me jumping ahead to the adoption without celebrating what happened last night.
That's
busiest
right.
Night again. It's just been getting busier and busier every night.
Yeah, we filled all the pens last night, and today we had to turn out about 25 ewes, and we've filled them up again. I think I got 6 or 7 pens left for tonight, and then I'm going to be scratching my head where to put them.
They're going to be in your kitchen, aren't they?
Wouldn't surprise me, I tell you.
Any signs? I know we've got some people keeping an eye on the ewes in the stone barn.
Yeah,
we've had a few lambs sort of up to the show. Anything?
Yeah, there's one in here just starting now. Yeah.
Okay, well, we'll be keeping an eye on her. Last night, yet again, the sheep took over the programme, and while Adam and I were talking about something, suddenly these delightful little triplets appeared into the world. There they are. All looking really different, Jim, aren't they?
Yeah.
And you can see this little speckly one, and she was the one that you decided to adopt on. We've seen this wet adoption, haven't we, a few times this week.
Gareth was helping up last night, and when that single was being, you seen it was a single, so he slammed it over top of a triplet and adopted that. It worked perfectly well, really.
But she decided she didn't want to stick around, and actually neither did Mum. So Gareth came in, he tied her legs together. Now that looks a bit brutal to me.
No, what it does is the other lamb hasn't stood up yet.
Right.
So if that lamb goes and sucks all the colostrum off it and runs off into a corner or something, so what we do is just put a little bit of string on the leg to stop him running away.
And that means then that the ewe can come in and start that bonding process.
That's right.
So there she, oh, I see.
It's been let off now. Look,
oh, look
not
at
a problem.
Standing up already and sucking the colostrum.
That's right.
That's brilliant. And Did it work?
Yeah, perfect.
Stuck? Can we go and see him?
No problem.
Which one is it?
It's this pen here.
This one here. Yeah. Oh, here she is, little speckly. Look at her.
Yeah, like a little second, but she loves it.
Aww. So. Can I just have a quick?
Yeah, of course you can.
Go on. Give us last show. You know, I want a lot of. I want a lot of lamb. Bonding. You're very, very sweet. Oh, that's very good news. Very good news, isn't it? I mean, you've had, as I say, a series of adoptions since we've been on air, and this is really one of the best ways of managing at lambing time, because it is a frantic time and you can't be bottle feeding everything. And
no, since you've been here, we've adopted 14 lambs.
Really?
Yeah, and everyone's worked.
Every single one has worked.
Yeah, it's a miracle, really.
And, I mean, you know, when we said 187 lambs since we've been here, is this a sort of standard lambing year for you, or has it been a particularly good or a particularly, you know, or a not particularly special one?
It's been very good, to be honest.
Has it?
Like, we've never scanned that many triplets all, so, well, and... Like, the singles have been going out with two instead of one, so it's a marvellous job.
So Shanks and Hercules,
all those months
ago, when we were doing our little testicle tickling, it's paid off.
They worked very well, they did, to be honest. I've had some very nice lambs over there. Yeah.
Jim, thank you very much. Now, I know that Adam is over with Kate Beavan, and they've got some old friends to catch up with.
Well, thanks, Kate. Very busy in the barns there. And that birthday box was quite difficult to get into, wasn't it?
It was very difficult to get into. Your knife was, you know, very substantial, but no, I still couldn't do the job.
Now, lots of people, including Claire and Anne, have been asking about one little family, a ewe with triplet lambs, and they were all a little bit poorly. So we're going to give you a little bit of a catch-up. Now, what happened here, Kate? They were a ewe with triplet lambs.
Yeah. She actually prolapsed and had to lamb her through the prolapse. They were tubed straight away at birth, and you can see there that Jim is putting the tube in again straight into the stomach so that the milk then warms up the little lamb, gives it the energy for it to survive.
And that first milk is very, very important, because the colostrum.
Yes, yeah, the colostrum they need to get in the first 24 hours, and that is essential for them to survive. So, yeah, really, really important.
Now, sadly, two of the little lambs did die, but you've still got the ewe over here. How's she getting on
now? We have, yeah. She's actually coming on really well. I mean, she's up on her feet now, which she wasn't for a while, and the little lamb, although we are still helping the little lamb, we're helping the little lamb with a bottle, doesn't need tubing anymore, and the little lamb is also suckling off mum now, which is great to see.
Yeah. So sadly she lost two, but, you know, it might be a happy ending and they could get out into the field sometime soon.
They could, you know, 4 or 5 days could be out in the fields. Fingers
now,
crossed, yeah.
Two little lambs that we've been following right from the start of Lambing Live are called Scarlet and O'Hara. So here's a little bit about their history. Now, this is a good time story, isn't it?
Yep.
This is a perfect presentation. Two front feet and nose first, twins born.
Yeah, very, very healthy lambs. Bonding with mum straight away. Jim marked them up, put them out in the field.
He takes them out on the quad bike in the trailer there.
Yeah, takes them out. They're numbered, so obviously, you know, if they get lost, we know who they belong to.
And Scarlet and O'Hara there are number 20, so the 20 on the side of lambs and the same number
and
on their mum,
so we can recognise mum and babies, yeah, exactly.
Well,
really good.
Our cameras were down in the field there this morning, and they're looking really well and healthy, aren't they?
They are. They're very good, healthy lambs, and they have got a very strong bond with mum and... Yeah, a good news story.
That's first few nights out in the field. I mean, it can be quite risky, can't it?
It can, yeah, particularly the first one, you know. I mean, if the lamb, they're in new territory, the lamb walks away from mum and doesn't get fed for a few hours, then, you know, it can get very, very cold, hypothermic, could die. So, yeah, very, very risky.
Staying with mum to get that food supply is really the essential bit, isn't it?
It is, yeah, it is, because not only with the milk, but obviously other predators as well. So, you know, they can be quite defensive, these mums.
It's all going thick and fast. Jim's saying lambing's been going very well.
Yep.
And our cameras were here at 1:30 this morning filming another birth, and that seemed to be going quite well as too.
Yeah, it's, you can see there, I think we've got a little clip. She's pushing away. And again, the bonding, you can see. I mean, the licking straight away is fantastic. Not only for the bonding, but also to dry the lamb as well.
Yeah, there's no towels in the sheds, is there? The ewes have to lick the lambs dry with their tongues.
Exactly, and if they don't, then we've got to get in with a straw and give them a good rub. You don't want them cold and wet.
And this one was up straight away, wasn't he? I mean, it's just incredible.
Yeah.
We called these two
Linford and Houdini, because yep. Linford was up on his feet there and within less than a minute.
Less than a minute, which is a good sign of a strong lamb. And yeah, and Houdini, well, he just lived up to his name, didn't
just
he?
Just extraordinary. I mean, he's up on his feet. Again, he's up and walking around in 5 minutes. That's pretty quick, isn't it?
It is very quick, but normal for good healthy lambs, but it is nice to see them up so quick.
And there he is. Like, he's trying to get out over the bars. And I think Mum comes back and brings him back out, doesn't he?
Yeah, he's making a great escape there.
Wonderful little lambs. Now, they were so strong that Jim's already turned them out.
Yeah, well, sometimes it happens, and we've been blessed this week with the really good weather as well. So they can be born during the night and out the next day, and they were an example of it, you know.
Well, one of the skills of sheep farming is being able to catch your animals, and it's not always that easy. Take a look at this.
I'm doing all the work here, Sinclair.
Bigger now than when you last filmed him.
He is a strong one.
Thanks.
I'll do that again.
We've got a four-horned Hebridean, and this is what it's all about. Big, big fella.
There you go.
You must have been a rugby player.
That's the sun.
I tell you, you know, you've taught me a lot in the last 6 months, but the one thing I still can't do is catch a full-grown sheep and flip it over like that. I mean, it is just so difficult. And your wife, little slip of a thing that she is, she can do it no problem at all.
She's stronger than she looks, I tell you.
She jolly well is. She jolly well is. I'll obviously have to keep practicing.
That's right.
Now, the thing about a final show, I think anyway, is that you're allowed to indulge yourself a little bit. So I'm going to share with you now, I think probably the most unforgettable moment in my last 6 months with the Beavan family, and that was helping to deliver my very first lamb.
She's had her first lamb?
Yeah.
The bag's coming out now.
Yeah.
What you're going to feel, if you slide your fingers in very carefully, can you see the one foot, you can feel another foot next to it. And if you slide above that, can you feel a head?
Yeah, I can feel the muzzle.
So, perfect presentation. What that means, it's going to be a nice, easy birth. What you need to do is very gently, if you can get hold of, you've got two legs, where's the other leg? Bring it out there. You've got two legs. If you can get hold of those two legs and just very gently pull slowly down. That's the way. That's it. Heads up. First thing I'm going to do is just clear the nose a bit. That's great. And a bit of wadge of straw is always good. And just give it a bit of a clean. A nice black lamb. Wow. And then very gently, just keep on pulling.
Keep pulling gently, Do I need to support the head? Or
it'll just slip out. That's it. Just keep pulling down. That's it. Now you just carry on pulling all the way around, right to the front, and show Mum the lamb. Yeah. That's it. Turn it the right way around. That's great. And put her right in front of Mum there, and she'll start licking. See? Congratulations.
How was that? Pretty slimy.
Slimy high five. Yay.
That was absolutely amazing.
Well done.
It really was absolutely amazing. It's still absolutely amazing, and I've helped deliver quite a few now.
You have, yeah, fair play.
And there she is, little Humble. Perhaps not the finest of your specimens.
No, it's not really,
but she's still here.
Yeah. You've got to try and keep them all alive if you can.
You absolutely have to try and keep them all alive, particularly my lamb.
She has been a bit of a pain, but never mind.
Well, we have got a little bit of hot news about Humble, but again, I'm going to tease you and I'm not going to tell you about that until later. Just a very quick thing before we resolve the big mystery of the night. Just come and look at this lamb. Look at this lamb, who is so cheeky and desperately wants to be on the telly all the time. You know that people say that dogs look like their owners? this lamb. Just
thank you very much.
Okay. Before I get slapped, let's resolve what's in the box? Come on, Jim, show us what it was.
Well, this is what was in the box. It's
gave you a bucket.
Well, it's looking like a bucket, but what it is a shepherdess.
Right.
Because you're leaving me. So I thought...
don't know that. I might be back on Monday.
I thought I'd replace you with a bucket.
Thanks. So, I'll make more jokes about that bald sheep in a minute.
Exactly. No, so what it is, it's a bucket where you can heat milk in.
Yeah.
And it's for orphan lambs.
Oh, well, they think it's a brilliant idea, don't they? So this is basically, instead of bottle feeding,
yes,
you can have a supply of milk that's kept warm...
Yep.
And the teats are permanently there, so it's kind of more like actually having a mum.
Very much so. Yeah, they can have milk ad lib then.
Let's see, have they worked it out yet?
Yeah, we've only gone in today, so I'll just have to draw the milk through.
Okay, so what do you do? Give it a bit of a squeeze. All right. Here you are, little ones. They're so greedy, these two. Humble, of course, is in the background, just looking on slightly disparagingly.
But what is this new tits on it at the moment, so they different
take a
little different to what they've been used to, so they just got to be trained onto these as well. Same sort of thing as if the mother...
Here you are, try it. Give it a go. Oh, go on. Yeah. Oh, I think we're working.
Away.
Yay!
He's away.
Come on, little one. So this is brilliant. So, I mean, presumably, if you end up, which hopefully you won't, but if you end up with lots of lambs that need bottle feeding, this is a really... a machine like this is a really practical solution for people
very
like you.
Very much so. Especially with the amount of triplets. If you can't adopt them all on and you've got a pen full of triplets, instead of bottle feeding sort of 10 lambs, which will take you a long time, they can take it ad lib yourself with this.
That's absolutely fantastic, isn't it?
Ah, it's a good machine.
So is it a good present in the end?
Yeah, very good. Thank you very much. Even though I couldn't get in the box.
Even though we wrapped it really badly. Talking of that box, though, that was that turned out to be quite useful, didn't it?
It was very useful, yes.
Yeah, now what happened here then, Jim?
Well, what it was, Sheepy, my mate, went round the fields this morning.
Yeah.
And that lamb had been rejected by his mother. As the BBC has been keeping a very good record, I went through the records and had a look, and it were her lambs.
Oh,
so it wasn't one of our adoptions or anything. So it's quite strange. Like, but I don't know why she had rejected it, but now we've put her in an adopter and put the lamb back with her. The lamb's sucking again.
So you put it in the box just to warm it up because she'd been rejected.
Yes, rejected for the night.
And lamb's now back with mum and hopefully all will be well.
Right. Yeah.
Look. You're not supposed to eat my trousers. You're supposed to eat that. I'm going to leave you to see if you can get these two to suckle on here.
No problem, all right.
And I'll see you a little bit later.
All right. See you later.
Now, the Beavan family breed sheep to produce lamb for what is one of Britain's most important agricultural industries. And earlier in the year, I joined Jim as he selected a few of his flock to take to the abattoir.
Rearing sheep is a year-round business that has its own natural cycle. Last year's lambs are now 10 months old. If they're left until they're over a year old, they're not classed as lamb anymore and are less valuable. The Beavans sell most of their lambs at market, but keep some back to sell in the family butcher's shop. Every week, Jim selects two or three lambs to take to slaughter.
So you want to drive them down to the gate?
Yep. Come on, girls.
Come on. Jim and I have driven this bunch of sheep into here, and then he will pick which ones are ready to go. They'll be driven up to the abattoir, left overnight so that they're nice and calm, and then tomorrow they'll be killed. Which I have to say I have very mixed feelings about. I kind of feel that as a meat eater, I absolutely should understand how an animal's life is ended so that I can then eat it. But I'm also a little bit soppy, and I've kind of got to quite like sheep over the last 6 months. So I feel very mixed about actually witnessing that moment between a live sheep and a dead sheep. So presumably a lamb that's ready to go is a lamb that's got a good weight on it.
You put your hand over there.
Yeah.
You've got excellent loin.
And it sounds awful to say it. You can actually feel the meat.
Yeah. If you put your hand on a dock here.
Yeah.
Right, you've got a nice dock. It's not too full.
So that dock bit, that top of the tail, That's how you establish the fat content of the meat.
And also, you just feel the vertebrae.
Yep.
That's a good line, that is.
Okay.
So that one there, I'll tag up and we'll take the day.
Now, why do you need to tag it up at this stage?
It's traceability, to be honest. So they'll know in the abattoir that's my lamb.
Right.
But so if there's anything wrong with it or anything like that, that's our identification. So we want two. If you have a look, we'll see what you think.
Well, that feels meaty. I can just feel the vertebrae, so it's not too fat. Let's try and get your dock. Yeah, and I'd say that's similar to that one.
So, as you chose that one, you're going to tag it?
Oh, Lord. Okay. Down through there.
Yeah, right. There you go.
Yep.
So, we'll have them two.
All right.
So, if I put them two in the pen on the bottom, we'll let the others out the field.
Okay.
And job done.
I've just put the ear tag in, which basically means there's no escape for my lamb. I feel a bit guilty now. Nope.
Oh, boy.
I've got you.
Two saddleback pigs are also leaving the farm today. Along with the lambs, they'll be sold in the Beavan family butchers in Abergavenny, run by Jim's brother, Hugh. Since the foot and mouth crisis, all farmers have to follow a strict chain of paperwork for every animal leaving the farm.
You take them yourself. Great. So we're ready to go.
Yep.
As we're about to leave, we discover the pigs that are staying behind have made a bid for freedom.
This is like animal revenge then. In all the excitement and kind of chaos, somebody, I'm not going to name names, forgot to shut the piglets back in their pen, so it's now pig mayhem. Order is restored. Sausages are on the menu.
The pigs were a welcome moment of light relief, but now it's time to get on with the more serious business of the day. Jim takes all his animals to a small, family-run abattoir, one of just a handful left in Wales.
Oh, boys.
There you go, boys.
New home for the night?
Yeah.
2 minutes. Oh, there you go.
Go on, then.
Tidy jump.
There we go. I know you've done this 100 times, Jim, but do you always feel a little bit emotional about this stage?
It's what we're in business for. Like, we produce lambs and pigs for the butchery trade. So, to be honest, I'm quite proud. It's like it's nice to see a finished animal, which when you see it hung up, and it's the right confirmation of what you want. It's gone right through circle. Like, so you've done the lamb in, you've taken them right through the summer, and you fed them, and to be honest, they've had a nice life. They haven't wanted for nothing, and I think it's quite fulfilling now. Yeah.
It's the last time Jim will see his lambs. They'll stay here overnight and be slaughtered in the morning.
Well, I think Jim summed that up very well, didn't he?
He really did, and you know, it made me think about it completely differently, actually. You know, you're sort of used to people, I don't know, producing prize vegetables or something, but you don't sort of think of it in that terms. But he's absolutely right. I mean, presumably you, when you produce good meat animals, you do feel very proud. You've done a great job.
It's exactly the same as Jim, yes. Yeah. I mean, you've done a really hard job to get that perfect animal, and you've, you know, looked after it so well throughout the months of its life, and then hopefully, you know, killing it isn't easy, but it's had a clean death and you've got a good product at the end of it.
And looking at the bigger picture, how important is the sheep industry to Britain?
Well, I think it's very, very important. I mean, we all know about sheep grazing, you know, the Lakeland Fells, the Yorkshire Moors, the Welsh Mountains, and it's grazing animals that keep those areas looking beautiful and as we love them. But also, you know, there's over 74,000 sheep farmers in Britain, and like the Beavan family, they're integral to the rural community. But I think probably most importantly is that Britain is the biggest sheep meat producer in Europe.
Really?
And it's worth a huge amount to the agricultural industry. In fact, £625 million.
That's staggering, because I was under the impression that we had to import a lot of lamb from New Zealand.
No, absolutely not. You know, we're 89% self-sufficient in sheep meat and in lamb in this country, and we export a lot of meat, particularly to France, which is, you know, great for sheep farmers.
But we've seen that, you know, you don't go into sheep farming to get rich, do you? I mean, lamb prices are quite good at the moment.
Yeah, they are. I mean, it's been a long time coming, but at the moment, you know, a sort of 40 kilo lamb is worth about 80 quid. So, you know, it is quite good. If you're good at sheep farming, you can start to make a little bit of money about it. And I know that you're thinking about keeping sheep, but what about the slaughtering? Have you thought about that?
It's a very good point. I mean, when I went into this, I thought, well, maybe I want to keep sheep at the end of it, but obviously, you know, I can't keep them as pets. That's not what they're for, you know, and I would love to be able to produce my own meat, but I did need to feel confident about that final stage. Could I take an animal to an abattoir? And a local abattoir actually very kindly invited me to go and see the whole process, no holds barred. And you know what? I was worried about it, and you just think that it's going to be very noisy and distressing and messy. Totally opposite.
Well, there's lots of legislation, isn't there?
There's lots of legislation, first of all, so there's a vet on hand, so the animal welfare is absolute. There's obviously meat inspectors at the other end of the process. But just the whole thing was very quiet, very clean, incredibly quick, and if it doesn't sound odd, kind of respectful. And so, yes, it made me think, actually, I can do this. Oh, you're coming in on our conversation.
Chicken coming to have a listen. Luckily, she just lays eggs.
It did make me think. But it did make me think, you know, I can do this because I have seen the whole process and I do feel very comfortable with it now.
Well, it is.
Our chicken is completely stealing the scene, isn't it? Here am I, trying to make a sensible point. It was my revelatory moment. It's been stolen by a chicken.
I think it's great the way you feel that you do, Kate.
Thank you.
But of course, sheep aren't all about meat. They produce lots of other products, and I went for a journey to find out more.
Seven hundred years ago, drovers' routes crisscrossed our countryside. Shepherds in the Cotswolds would have walked their flocks to market. Britain was famed for its wool. Merchants came from all over Europe to buy our golden fleeces. The medieval wool trade boomed in England to such an extent that in the 14th century, it provided half the crown's tax revenues.
A lot of the history of sheep has been to do with how diverse they are as an animal. At one time, it was all about wool, and this is a Cotswold, a great big sheep with lots of long, lustrous wool. And the Cotswold actually gave its name to this area. A sheep cot is a sheep enclosure, and a wold is a rolling hill. So there were thousands of sheep cots on the rolling hills, the Cotswolds. But then, the introduction of synthetics meant that wool became less popular, and really it became more about meat.
We're a nation of lamb lovers. We eat more of it than anyone else in Europe. But historically, this multi-purpose animal was also highly prized for its milk. Sheep's milk was a staple part of our diet until more productive cows started to take over in the Middle Ages. But fashions can return. I'm on my way to Ramhall Farm in the Midlands. I've heard about a sixth generation farmer who decided to get out of milking cows Stephen Fletcher now runs a sheep dairy to make cheese. His Friesland sheep are off for milking. And they even know the way.
We just washed the teats. It's a weak solution of water and iodine. We're making an unpasteurised product.
Yeah.
So obviously, you know, cleanliness in the milking parlour is absolutely paramount.
This may look strange, but we used to have a rich heritage of making sheep's cheese here in Britain. On the continent, they still produce feta and roquefort.
How often are you milking your ewes?
We milk twice a day.
And when you're at your full capacity, how many ewes are you milking at one time?
Somewhere between 550 and 600.
Crikey, so you've got 3 hours of milking, really, morning and evening.
Oh, yeah.
Every day of the week, including Christmas Day.
They don't seem to mind being milked. In fact, they're queuing up for their turn. And it's my chance to try my hand at milking.
And once the milk flow stops, just a gentle push up and pull down and it comes off.
Just that last little bit in the udder there, you tilt the udder up, it comes through the clusters, these little areas that suck the teat. There's a pulsator in there sucking the teat. The milk comes down the pipe, into here, through a filter, and up into the tank.
It takes a special kind of sheep and lots of feed to produce enough milk to make this all worthwhile. The fresh milk then flows through for cheesemaking right next door. Linda adds a starter culture to develop lactic acid. But the magic ingredient is rennet, a natural enzyme that coagulates the milk.
Right, come this way, Adam.
It's a bit warmer in here.
It's lovely and warm in here.
An hour later, and it's set.
I'm just going to touch the surface so you can see.
Oh, yes, like blancmange. And this tank is warm, isn't it? Just keeping it
about
the right temperature.
It is. It's got a hot water jacket round. It's keeping it at about 29, 30 degrees.
There are three tanks, each at a different stage of production.
So this one's ready to slice up?
This one's ready to cut and start heating. So we do two cuts. It's going to go into pea-sized pieces. Does it look lovely?
It's quite satisfying, isn't it? And this will help separate the curds from the whey.
That's right. The curd is the protein, the fat, all the milk solids. The whey mostly is water. There's a little bit of solids in it, but hopefully minimal amount because we want as much cheese out of it as we can get.
The curd sinks to the bottom and it needs a good stir.
Here we go, Adam, you'll enjoy this bit.
Put
the glove on, long glove. Slide your hand in.
Yeah.
And just very slowly loop it round and under.
Oh, that's just the best, isn't it?
On a cold day, this is lovely.
What's it like making cheese for a living?
It's extremely satisfying. It's the most satisfying job I've ever had, particularly with the sheep being on the farm. You see the whole process from start to finish.
Once mixed, it's heated at 40 degrees for an hour.
What's the trick now, then?
Now we're going to take the curds, lift the curds out with your colander.
So just scoop it in and get a good...
Scoop it out, take it over to the
table. Is that
too much? That's a little bit too much, but you need two lots, so half one to start with, and then we'll keep filling it up.
Yeah.
Oh, so if you start just pressing it in, squeeze it down.
This is squeezing out of the way.
Squeezing out of the way, just by hand.
The moment of truth. Will my cheese come out in one piece?
All right. Actually, hand on each side and slide it in gently. And then a quick squeeze on top, Adam. Beautiful. And another beautiful burnt swirl.
Salt is added to draw out moisture. And later, it's painted with a protective rind before being stored to mature for at least 3 months.
Incredible sight.
Isn't it super?
How many cheeses have you got in the store here?
1,700 in this store, and there's two more stores this size, then a smaller one with 1,300 in it.
Goodness me, and they're all maturing at different stages?
They're all maturing at different stages.
Does that mean we can taste some?
Well, we're going to taste some, definitely. This is a cheese iron from which we take a core sample.
How long do they mature for?
They mature for a minimum of 3 months. I personally like them at 5 to 6 months old. Some people like the very young cheese. If you just take a piece out, break a piece out, and taste that.
That's great.
This is quite mild tasting, quite creamy. It's lovely. It's a very young cheese. That cheese is only just 3 months old.
And as it gets older, it gets stronger.
It gets stronger. And dries out a little bit more too.
And the ultimate question, is it profitable? I suppose if it wasn't, you wouldn't be doing it.
We're diversifying, we're keeping going on the farm. It's hard work, it's a lot of hard work for the money you earn from it. Very labour intensive, but very satisfying.
It's great to see a return to these traditions. Having travelled all across the UK, it's been wonderful to see so many breeds thriving. From the seaweed-eating sheep of North Ronaldsay to the hardy Herdwicks in the Lake District, they all play a vital role.
There really are so many things that sheep provide for us that we take for granted, not least shaping this beautiful landscape that we live in. And as a sheep farmer, I really think it's important to keep all our different breeds of sheep going, because you never know just what we might need from them in the future.
Yes, sheep are incredible things. I've just come into the stone barn, and if my minimal experience tells me anything, Kate, is that you sort of thinking about possibly lambing?
She is. She's in the early stages. She's been pawing at the ground a bit, looking a bit restless, you know, grinding the teeth.
Right.
A few contractions coming on there,
so. Okay, well, we'll keep an eye on her. Maybe pushing our luck if she gave birth. What do you think?
Don't know. I'm not sure. Could be within the last sort of 5-10 minutes, maybe.
Well, stay tuned. Have you ever thought about sort of doing cheese rather than meat, or cheese and meat? I mean, I know that farmers sort of do need to diversify these days.
Yeah. I mean, we've got the bed and breakfast and the butcher shop.
Yeah.
But, you know, you've got sort of kids, farm, work, doing a part-time master's. You think. Not a lot of time, actually, for everything else at the moment.
And it does look like you need an awful lot of kit. It would be an enormous investment, wouldn't it?
It would be, yeah. Yeah, you'd need to speculate to accumulate that. Yeah. You need to put the money in and big words on
the... you'd probably need to sort of actually change the infrastructure of the farm for those sorts of sheds and all that sort of thing.
You would. And I think the way we've got it at the moment, it works well for us. So,
yes.
You know.
Yeah.
But you don't know what the future brings, so...
No. That's true. So you stay flexible, really.
You do.
Now, I've got a question for you, especially for you, from Lydia Jones, who's 10. It's a sort of two-part question, so I'll start with part one.
Okay.
She wants to know, will the ewes that are lambing now be kept to lamb next year?
Yes, they will, unless, you know, we check them over, as you know, before we put the tups in, unless there are any major problems, then most of them will. When they get to a certain age, you know, they can no more, then they move on, but most of them will be,
And the other thing she wants to know is, do you keep any of the lambs, which you will then breed from next year, or do they all get sold?
Right, no, we do keep some, what we call replacement ewe lambs, so some of the female lambs may be kept next year, and again, we sort them out close to the time, and then we can breed from them. So yes, some of them will.
So you are bringing. I mean, you're presumably buying in a certain number of ewes as well, are you, every year, or do you try just
year,
to generate your own?
No, we try to generate our own. I mean, obviously this year we did get some very prolific mules in. Hence the triplets.
Hence the triplets. Well, thank you very much indeed, Kate. Now, as Kate said, farming is all about diversification. And the Beavan family may not be going into cheese production anytime soon, but if you're producing meat that you're proud of, then it seems sensible to sell it as well. And I spent a day with Jim's brother Hugh at the Beavan family butcher shop. That's your whole lamb carcass.
Yeah.
Oh, there we go.
Come from the abattoir.
Okay. They're quite big animals, actually. You don't really realise it.
Well, they seem to look
until
bigger.
You see them.
They seem
like
to look
that.
Bigger when they're dead than what they do live.
They do, don't they?
No, what we're going to do is try and split them.
Okay.
Right down the middle of the back.
Mm-hmm.
Some people do it with a chopper. I prefer to do it with a saw.
Okay, so I've got that half. Oh, that's quite heavy. So hang it up there. Okay. the majority of the meat that you sell in this shop is produced on your farm. God, that's great, isn't it? So you absolutely know the provenance of your meat, you know exactly where it's come from. Your brother's looked after it, so any problems, well, you can go round and give him hell.
I do.
While we get to grips with butchering a lamb, Hugh's wife Jan is out front dealing with customers.
Two lamb chops, please. Little ones in the front.
In the front.
It's time to cut my first lamb chop. And now I can see why they're called chops.
Keep this hand well out of the way.
Yeah.
Because you're not going to cut this hand with that, are you?
No.
Right? So all I do is like cut them, just ease them open a little bit.
Yeah.
Here's your lamb chop.
You make it look very easy. So, I put it in.
Yeah.
Open it up a bit.
Yeah.
Okay. And then just give it a good old wallop.
Yeah. Give it another good wallop.
Oh, I can get dangerous with that, Hugh.
Look at that.
That's my first chop.
Mm. Yeah, kind of a bit thicker, if you like.
About there?
Yeah.
The loin chops come from the bottom end of the lamb's ribcage, just along from the rack, which is the most expensive part of the lamb.
Oh, that made my ears ring. How much does it cost to produce one lamb?
At the moment, lambs are making a good price. They're making £80.
For a live lamb?
And I can just about get a lamb to come to about £100 in year.
So you would only make £20
profit? At the moment.
Yeah.
But when lambs were making £35, butchers were still making...
£100 an animal. Mm. So you must feel quite torn, because obviously you're still involved in the family business, the farming business.
Right.
But the better price you get for the lambs, the less money you make as a butcher.
That's right.
It is amazing, having spent the time with your family over these last months and seeing how much work goes into producing enough lambs to make a living, it's actually puts it into perspective, and it is that constant battle between consumers wanting good, cheap food, but farmers having to make a living and be able to produce it.
I spent all day making hundreds of burgers, faggots and sausages and had a good taste of daily life as a butcher. Now it's time for me to get behind the counter and give it the hard sell.
Can't persuade you to take one of those lovely sausages. We made those ones this morning.
Oh, did you?
They're just pork sausages, but very, very good, mixed by my own fair hands.
Okay, then.
How many would you like?
Four.
Thank you.
Thank you
very much.
Thank you.
See you again.
Yeah.
Bye. Well,
you're
let that be
butcher.
A warning to you. Next time I have a chopper in my hand.
Humble with a cleaver. Now, I've got a little seat here for you, because I know
it,
it's...
Is it time for Adam and Kate's question time?
It is.
Actually, well, OK, and then I'm going to kick off with this one from Julie Hitchcock, because she wants to know, rather appropriately after our butcher shop film, when is lamb and then becomes mutton?
Well, as I understand it, they're lambs until they're a year old, and then they grow their first two teeth, and then they become hogget, and then after that, they become mutton.
Oh, well, there you are. There you are, Julie. That was nice and simple. This one's a little bit more complicated. Now, Tony and Sarah Sullivan and Charlotte in London wanted to know why sheep differ in colour. So, for example, like the triplets that were born last night, you had one little speckly one, one sort of brownier one, one paler one, you know, Humble was black, her sibling is white. So how does that happen?
Well, it's all a little bit complicated, but really, the Beavan sheep here are crossbred sheep. So the mule has got some blue-faced Leicester in it and some Swaledale in it, and then the ewe goes to a Charolais ram, so there's three different breeds mixed in there, and then some of their sheep are Suffolk crosses. So there's all different colours, so you can get all the colours you just mentioned.
Yeah.
But then when you get a black one and a white one, that's a recessive gene that needs to come from both parents to produce that little black lamb.
Right.
So then they come all different colours. So like little Beavan.
Little Beavan.
little Humble. Little Heaven.
No.
Oh, Humble Beavan. Who?
Yes. Humble, and that reminds me.
Ah.
I'm not sure I can admit I bought her.
Oh, no.
Well, Jim doesn't really want her, and I sort of do. And look, she's doing so well. She's eating now, and she's hiding. She's being a little bit shy.
You haven't got any other sheep.
I know I haven't got any other sheep, so she needs company. And there's a man I know who's got quite a few sheep.
Oh, I know where this is going.
So she's going to come and live with you.
Oh, lovely.
Will you take her?
I will. Of course I will. She's such a fine example of a sheep. Not. But I'd love to have her, Kate.
You'd love to have her. Little Humble on your farm, you know, when you're missing me, when this is all over.
Oh, yeah.
Humble, you're going to go and live in the Cotswolds and you'll love it. Right, let's move on. Ross wants to know, how old does a ewe have to be before she can have her first lambs?
Right, well, she can lamb as a lamb. Mm. So the lamb's born in the spring, and if they're big enough, you know, sort of 50 kilos in weight, then they're sexually mature and big enough to be able to conceive. And so they can go to the ram and have lambs on their first birthday.
Okay.
Not very many sheep farmers do that. Some do. But most people leave them until they're two. So they'll go to the ram in the second autumn of their life and then have babies on their second birthday.
And does that tend to be better for the ewe, or is it just simply how good a condition they're in at that early age?
It does, really. The lambs have to be big enough and strong enough, and then you do have to look after them during the winter while they're pregnant if you're going to lamb lambs. But most people will lamb them when they're two.
And do they get more experience, you know, every year? Does that actually make a difference to the sort of mother they are?
Absolutely, definitely, yes. Young females, you know, when they're giving birth, sometimes have more problems, but they're much more nervous and inexperienced, and as they get older and have more and more lambs, they get better at it.
And the final question, which came from the very appropriately named Sarah Shepherd, she wants to know, how long a ewe is productive for?
Right, here we are. This is a little lesson. Come along.
Okay, come on then.
In here, a sheep has teeth on the front of its mouth, and they only have them on the bottom jaw.
Right.
And when they're babies, they have baby teeth. Yeah. And then those drop out, and then they grow big teeth.
Yeah.
And they grow two in the first year. So there's the first two in their first year. And then this one is growing the second two. So when she's four-tooth, and then six-tooth, and then full mouth.
Right.
And then she's a fully grown sheep. And once her teeth start dropping out, then she really can't eat all the hard food and she's no longer productive.
So that's it. So it's basically two teeth a year, roughly. So
that's
they
it.
Get to about...
Well, yeah, for 5 or 6 years old.
Yeah.
And then they can live for a long time. I mean, sheep probably live up to sort of 10 or 12 years. I suspect people are going to be writing and saying, oh, I've got a sheep who's 15.
But, but that's about it. Okay, fine. Thank you very much. That was Adam's question and answer session for the last time. But this farm has been in the family for 70 years, and three generations of Beavans have worked this land. Now here, the family are going to look back at the time when Trevor's father was farming here, and then look forward to the fourth generation.
I started with a horse and cart. It's so different labour-wise. I mean, we used to have two or three men on the farm working, plus Dad, and now it's just Jim, really, in a sense, like, you know, Jim and Hugh and myself. Well, I don't do that much now. When I was farming, we had little bales, little square bales, and you used to put them on the trailers and cart them in. Used to be half a dozen of us doing the work. Now you can bale it with a big baler. The tractors come along, pick the bales up, but there's no hard work at all to it. It's so easy.
They had it very tough, really, when you think about it. Now, I got a big tractor with a loader on the front of it. I can do most of the feeding on my own. It's a lovely satisfaction to know that you're producing something and you've done it to the best of your ability. You've enjoyed doing it. You've got them to the stage where they're tip-top, and it's a beautiful way of life. It's in your blood, it is.
Dad bought the farm in 1940. He farmed it, and then he left it to myself, and we're just custodians of the countryside. We're just passing through, really, and another phase, another generation will hopefully take over, and I'm fortunate to have the sons and the grandsons to take on from myself.
They got a son, Sam, who's very interested in farming. Sam loves the outdoors. He does. He's like a caged animal when he's inside. He's getting to the age where he comes with me, helps me with the sheep, helps me with the cattle. And I think we're very, very similar people.
I love the sheep and cattle. It'd be nice if I can run it when I'm older, so I'm gonna try to.
I would love to see him farming, and I'd love to farm alongside him.
What's up?
Kelly will never know, she's got Kate's sort of instinct with animals. I wouldn't be surprised if she went into the same sort of thing as Kate, and taught sort of animal husbandry and things like that.
As a family, we get to work together. We can have all our meals together. If we've got a bit of time in the afternoon, I'll take the kids off for a bit of a nature trail around the farm. It is a cliche, but it's a way of life, and it's an amazing way of life.
Hugh up the other farm, he's got two boys who are very interested in farming as well, especially Daniel. He's a very good farmer. And it'd be lovely to see the generations farming together like me and my brother have.
She said piglets yesterday. Don't really do as pets, because we know they're going to go to kill to the butcher shop. But I just do it because I like the animals, you know.
Who knows who will be the farmers in the future, but no doubt somebody will take it on and carry on with the farming there. And hopefully it'll carry on 5-6 generations, you know. Be nice to think it would anyway, after all the work that has been put into the farm, you know, over the years.
This place, I hope, will never ever be sold out to the Beavan family. It's a part of my heart. I love the farm. It is a special, very special place to me, and I hope it is to my kids and their grandchildren.
Well, can you believe it? It's our final show, and a sheep has stolen the scene again. We've got another birth going on just in the corner, and Jim is just attending to that ewe at the moment. Kate, it must be quite hard for you. You know, you've come into a farming family that has been a farming family for generations, but your family aren't a farming family.
No. I'm from a little village called Little Eccleston up in Lancashire, which is a very rural community.
Yeah.
But no, my family themselves are not farmers. So
I think we should say hello to your family.
I'd like to give them all a big A up. That's all right.
Up north. Kate's family.
Thank you.
But how do you feel about Sam and Kellen being, you know, possibly part of the fourth generation of Beavan farmers in this area?
It's amazing, and that film is very, very powerful, you know. Choke me. It's lovely. I mean, my family do come up as well. They come to Wales, you know, they visit, but for Sam and Kel, I just think it's just an amazing way of life, and yeah, I'm in awe. I mean, I've been here nearly 20 years and still in awe when I see them running around the fields and, you know, going fishing, as you saw there.
Yeah,
so,
yeah.
Fantastic.
I think those little lambs are born now over there.
Are they? Can we just go and check over and just have a look? Jim, set of twins, it looks like, there.
Yeah, good set of twins.
All successfully done. Well, it has been the most incredible 6 months for me, and a huge privilege to have been here with this wonderful family and to have learned so much from them. And the culmination has been this roller coaster last 5 days. So let's sit back and look at what has been Lambing Live.
Stand by, Kate. Here we go.
Three.
And two.
Sit back, enjoy the very first Lambing Live. Oh, they're lambing right now.
There you go.
Okay.
She's dotted for triplets, and it's quite a big lamb here that Jim is helping to give birth to. Sam's in charge there, around in the front. Just going to put it in front of the ewe's nose.
Yeah, oh, very nice.
Is. And Mum's straight away licking them as well, which is a lovely, lovely sign.
Real step.
Yeah. Sheep took over the show. Come on, girl.
bit.
I'm not joining in with this.
Oh, come on.
You're not me. I don't do that. If you wake them up and they stretch like that means they're fit and healthy.
We have to crack on with the question of castration.
That's when you want to learn.
Yeah, is a girl allowed to do this? They felt quite good to me.
No, bravo.
If they were girls, it would be like having a Brazilian.
Very much so. Yeah, a bit of a surprise for you, yeah?
That's your first lamb of the year.
Yeah. Get in there.
Oh, this is not inflating his lungs. Come on, little fella.
Take your gun. I'm tough enough.
No, you are. You're that.
There's just something horrible about watching a little life ebb away. It's just really hard, and I don't know how anyone ever gets used to that.
They are.
You're making a right mess of it.
Covered on that.
I can't believe that this is going on. We've got escape plans.
You're like a proud mum.
Really, it's that ultimate combination, isn't it? An ultimate combo that someone hit upon once and found out that these mules were so good.
It must have just been somebody messing around with sheep. As
it often happens up here in Yorkshire on a lonely night.
Oh my God, here he goes.
That's the most amazing bit of sheep herding I've ever done.
Terrible top. The last of them. Oh, there you go. It's all looking rather quiet on the in the lambing sheds, but then the sheep have surprised us before, and no doubt we'll do it again.
7 new lies have appeared in the world since we've been on air.
Well, we've got all the Beavans with us here now, and I have to say, from Kate and I and the whole Lambing Live team, a huge thank you to all of you. It really has been an amazing experience.
It's been absolutely fantastic. Now, if you're a little bit worried that you are going to be going into lambing withdrawal symptoms and you're not going to be able to bear to go through another night without lambing, well, don't worry, because down to popular demand, BBC Two is going to be running a Lambing Live special on Saturday night, starting at 7:30. But that really is it. So all that is left to be said is a goodbye from Adam, from me, from all the Beavans, from all the sheep, and of course, Lassie. Bye, everybody.
Bye. Bye. Bye.